Thank you, and thanks very much for those definitions and introduction. I hope that I adhere to those definitions now fairly well. I think I do, and thanks all of you for coming. So my topic is core stability, does it matter? I also just want to point out that in addition to being at Ohio State University in Columbus, Ohio, I'm also co-founder and chief technical officer of this tiny small business, Perfect Practice. And the reason I mention that is because the baseball data I'm going to present was collected, or some of it was collected with an app called the Level Belt Pro, which we've since commercialized with that company. But the research itself was funded by National Institutes of Health, Tech Columbus, which is part of the state of Ohio in the USA, and then Ohio State University. So Dr. Van Dien talked about where the core is, as well as whether stability matters, and or not whether it matters, but how we define it. Now, as far as whether it matters, I think if we look at the ergonomic literature, looking at low back pain and low back function, there's a lot of data out there, and very intuitively, you look at where those muscles are, they cross the lumbar spine, so we can agree that that's going to be very important for those sorts of functional movements. But what's not as clear is if we look at a throwing activity or running or lower extremity activities, whether core stability still matters. And so that's really what I'm going to focus on in my talk. So first I'm going to talk about sort of this basis of musculoskeletal injury from a mechanical engineer point of view, a little bit of the video evidence that's out there implicating core, some prospective evidence. There's not very much, but there's some out there now. And then where we're going in the future as far as looking at interventions or simulations to establish causality, whether having better core stability or worse core stability leads to an increase or decrease in your risk of athletic injury. So thinking about how injuries happen. How does an injury happen? Well, if you're just sitting in your chair all day watching World Cup, you're not going to get an injury. You have to have elevated loads on at-risk structures. Now, where do those elevated loads come from? They may come from the anatomy. They may come from external loads, such as gravity and opposing player, equipment. And they also come from your motor control strategy. Now, when we look at the literature for upper extremity and lower extremity injuries, say, for example, the knee, most of what we find over the last 20 years plus is looking at the anatomy of the knee, the external loading applied to the knee, or say the strain in the ACL, for example, and then the motor control strategy of the quadriceps, the hamstrings, the gastroc, those muscles that cross the knee itself. So it's very localized examination that's been done mostly. But I think all of you in this room and many of us are really thinking more broadly now about how the whole body works together. So that brings us to the question whether proximal control can affect the extremities. So now, how does the trunk motor control strategy lead to elevated loads on at-risk knee, shoulder, or elbow structures? So first, let's look at a little bit of video evidence from ACL injuries. So one study published by Hewitt et al. In 2009 looked at actual injury events, recorded videos from games, and was looking at the frontal plane. So what they found was among female athletes, there was an association between lateral trunk motion and medial knee collapse. So here you can see this red line relative to blue is that lateral trunk motion relative to vertical. And then they found in women who had more of this motion, they had more of a medial collapse. And this one, you don't see very much of it, but some medial collapse or valgus collapse of the knee. Sheehan et al. Looked at sagittal views of ACL injury events, again, videos from games. And she found that in the control subjects, you see a trunk that's maybe slightly flexed, and then the foot, or the sort of base of support, is directly below the center of mass. In contrast to injury events where the athlete may be leaning backward even, or certainly more upright, and then the center of mass is posterior to that base of support. Okay. So again, this lateral trunk position may be associated with female ACL injury events. Posterior upright trunk position may be associated with male and female ACL injury events. But interpretation of the video is very limited. I don't know if you noticed, but those videos are quite blurry. The first one, it's not clear if we are looking at a purely frontal view or not. So, you know, the video quality, the angle, and the frame rate are never exactly what you'd like to have. And we also don't know when the injury happens. They've assumed a specific frame in time when they think the injury has occurred, but we don't really know if that's after the injury has occurred and this is a response to the pain, or if it's happening just before the injury. We also can't tell if this is a stability or control problem, like a deficit, or if it's something else, meaning a strategy that the athlete is trying to employ, whether it's to fake an opponent or to get maximum power in sort of a stretch shortening cycle, perhaps. But the best value for these videos, I think, is really to help us develop hypotheses that we can test with more quantitative approaches. So that brings me to some prospective evidence. But before I do that, I want to define a term that I tend to use, lumbopelvic control. And I used to use trunk control, but then I got into trouble with the people who really believe that the pelvis is very important. So now I've broadened how I call it to lumbopelvic control. But my definition, which I think agrees fairly well with Dr. Van Dien's, is that it's the combination of factors that result in active movement, quote unquote, of the lumbar spine and pelvis in the presence of a perturbation. And those factors include strength, they include endurance, they include muscle activation patterns as well. And by active movement, I mean either to accelerate, decelerate, or stabilize the trunk and hips. So the first picture on top is a deceleration example. If you imagine the gymnast going around and then trying to stop himself in this position, he's trying to decelerate his body. The middle one is a stabilization example. The two players are running trying to run in straight lines toward the ball, but they're bumping each other and they're trying to stabilize themselves along that course. And then the bottom one is a batter trying to accelerate that bat to swing against the ball. So there have been a couple of studies that were done at Yale University. Dr. Cholowicki was the senior author on these, looking at lumbopelvic proprioception and control deficits and their association with knee injury incidence. So I know he's going to talk more about these tests, so I'll just very briefly say what they are. So the first one on the top left is a proprioception task. So the person's upper body is fixed. The experimenter rotates them a certain number of degrees, then brings them back to neutral and asks the person to reposition back to that angle. And you can look at the error in repositioning, and that gives you some estimation of their trunk proprioception. So this graph is too small to see the numbers, but the y-axis here is repositioning error in degrees. And then we have them grouped by whether they later went on to suffer a knee injury, a ligament or meniscus injury of the knee, or an ACL injury. And these are varsity intercollegiate athletes from Yale University. So the black bar, which hopefully stands out to you, is the females who later went on to get injured. And they have greater repositioning error. And in fact, in their logistic regression, they found that among women, this repositioning error was associated with 3 times greater risk of a knee injury through the course of the season. Now, they also did this control task, which Dr. Van Dien also showed. So in this one, the lower body is fixed. There's a cable. The subject pulls isometrically against it, and then it's released at a random time, creating a releasing perturbation now that they have to respond to. So they're trying to catch themselves to keep from falling. And so you can look at the displacement in degrees again of the trunk. So here on the y-axis, again, we have displacement after this perturbation. And again, the knee, ligament, and ACL injuries. And then the gray bars are the athletes who later went on to get injured. So this is males and females together. And with the logistic regression analysis, they found that among all athletes, those with a greater displacement after this perturbation were 2 times greater risk of having a knee injury. So that's with lower extremity injuries, knee injuries in specifics. So in my lab, we've been looking at baseball pitching. So these are overhead throwing athletes and looking at their control. Now we did a slightly different test, actually very different test. So the one we did is called a single leg raise. But again, you're applying a perturbation and looking at motion. So here, there's a little block. Actually, this is a box of tissues. We have instrumentation to measure anterior or posterior tilt of the pelvis. We ask the subject to lift one leg while keeping their waist as horizontal as possible. And then we look at how much anterior posterior motion they get away from neutral, from the starting position. These are my collaborators here, physical therapists and primary care sports medicine. So this is the distribution of this, we call it AP score, which is again the peak deviation away from the neutral starting position when they just do this motion. So you can see there's a distribution of how much motion we get. And we, just using the median, we classified people as having good lumbopelvic control. Those are the green ones. And red are the poor lumbopelvic control. So that breakdown was at 7 degrees of deviation. Then we looked at what their performance was through the course of the season. We did this test right before the beginning of the competitive season during spring training, for those of you who are familiar with baseball. So again, we want to know, does this test of lumbopelvic control relate to performance through the course of the season? So we looked at a few different performance parameters, but the two that were most important to the coaches were these things called walks plus hits per inning pitched, and then the total number of innings pitched. So just to orient you to these graphs, on this curve here, I've ranked all the major leagues. So this is the top league professional baseball pitchers in 2009. So 100th percentile is the best pitcher, 0th percentile is the worst in the major leagues. Now my pitchers that we tested were in the lower league. But the red dot is the mean for those who had poor control, and the green dot is those who had good control. And you can see there's a difference here, and this was statistically significant with effect sizes that were moderate to large. And in addition, this number is about 22 innings, or about 40% more innings pitched, and this is about one walk or hit per 9 innings, which is enough to determine the win or loss in the game, perhaps. So we showed this to the coaches, and they said, well, that matters. But what really matters to us is injury, because we're losing all these players to ulnar collateral ligament tears and other types of injuries. So then we had to develop the Better Sensor, which is this iPod app, which allowed us to record much more rapidly. Again, it's the same single leg raise test, and we're looking at this anterior posterior motion or deviation when you lift one leg. So now we have a much larger cohort of subjects. We had 405 who were enrolled. And we broke them up actually into three categories. So we split it 4 degrees deviation, 8 degrees deviation from the neutral starting position. So we have good control, moderate control, poor control. And then in baseball, I don't know how many of you watch or follow baseball, but it's very common for players to miss a day of practice or a game because of elbow soreness, shoulder soreness, back soreness. But missing a couple of days is not really very meaningful. So we decided to say, well, what if you miss 30 days? This is, depending on what league you're playing, that could be as much of as a third of the season. So we said, what is the likelihood of missing 30 or more days through the course of the season? And again, we performed this test at the beginning of the season, and then the team's medical staff reported the days missed to us. So now here are the percent who missed 30 or more days. 12% of those with good control, 16% with moderate control, 35% of those with poor control. And this one is statistically significantly greater than the other two. So if they had poor control, they had a greater risk of missing significant time due to injury through the course of the season. And these injuries were limited to anything that we can attribute to pitching. So if they were in a collision or they got hit with a ball or something like that. We didn't count those days missed, only ones that are attributable to pitching. Now, we also were interested in severity. So we looked at how many days each pitcher missed. So out of here, let me look, show you this number. Out of the 347 pitchers who stayed with the same team, so we have full injury data, only 108 missed one day. So two-thirds of the pitchers never missed a single day from pitching in practice or a game. But out of these 108 who missed at least one day, when we look at those with poor control, they missed significantly more days through the course of the season. Now, what does that mean? Due to the way that the reporting was happening, it was telling us cumulative days missed. So we aren't sure if there were recurrences of injuries or it's different injuries. But we know that either the injuries are either more severe, meaning a single injury results in more days missed, or there's a greater frequency of recurrent injuries. Either way, this is something probably worth working on for those baseball pitchers. Now, another question you might ask for whether it matters, and this is something we talk about in ACL research all the time, is if you have a factor that's not modifiable, then we should maybe not even think about it because we can't do anything about it. So the question then is whether lumbopelvic control is modifiable. Now, Dr. Peterson and his group in Copenhagen, Denmark, did a very nice study suggesting that it is modifiable. So they looked at novice adult women who, with no soccer experience, they put them, randomized them either into a recreational soccer league, a running club, or no exercise. And so they participated for 16 weeks twice a week. And their lumbopelvic control task was this, which I would call a sudden force tug, similar to a release, but the perturbation is there's a weight that drops and tugs on the torso. But again, the lower body is more or less fixed. And they found that their soccer players got significantly better at this task, whereas the runners did not change at all. And they did a very nice job of controlling for intensity of that exercise. Obviously, the duration of exposure is the same, but even the exercise intensity as measured by heart rate monitors was similar between the runners and the soccer players. But then they also did something very interesting. They watched the soccer matches to see what they were doing, what the athletes were doing, and they called these, counted these things called specific movements, which were anything other than running straight ahead in a straight line. So if you change direction, if you head a ball, if you kick a ball, if you bump an opposing player, if you slide tackle, if you are slide tackled, any of those things count as a specific movement. And there are a lot of these movements, 3.2 movements per minute on average through the course of these basically 32 exposures. So they attribute, and I think that makes a lot of sense, that this sort of task specificity of training people by giving them experience in experiencing perturbations and responding to those perturbations is what's making the difference in their ability to control that core. So what are we doing in the future? We still think there's a problem here that all of these studies are really associations, right? They're not establishing causality between core stability, trunk control, and other things that we care about, such as knee loading, shoulder loading, et cetera. So we're trying to establish causality using interventions and computer simulations. So here's the first one. This study has been funded for almost a year now. We've been looking at the role of lumbopelvic control in running, distance running, using what we call a lumbopelvic control knockdown protocol. So we basically instrument the subject, we have them run in the lab, then we do this protocol, this sort of cycle of doing an assessment of their lumbopelvic control, so their response to a perturbation, having them do exercises that are really focused on those core muscles, and then repeating, and then continuing this cycle until we see a degradation in their response to perturbation, then we bring them right back out and have them run again to see if the loading on the lower extremity has changed. So this study has several steps. The first step, which I think is going to lead right into Dr. Chulowiecki's talk, is picking the right assessment. Because we know we want to perturb that core, and we want to quantify the response objectively. So we've tried several tests. These are just three of the ones we've tried. This one on the left is basically an adaptation of the one from Denmark, where the subject's lower body is fixed. We tug at the torso and look at the displacement, either of this cable in centimeters or in degrees of the torso. This one is an unstable sitting, so an adaptation of one from the University of Kentucky, which is an adaptation of one from Dr. Chulowiecki, which is an unstable sitting here. And we're looking at the movement of the center of pressure as well as movement of the pelvis during 30 seconds with eyes closed on a single leg. Then the third one here, this is a time to stability task where the person receives a medicine ball and then they try to stabilize as quickly as they can, and we can look at how fast they're able to damp out that oscillation. So step two then is to pick the right exercises, right? Because we want to reduce their lumbopelvic control, but we don't want to affect the lower extremity muscles because that would confound the results of the running test. So we've been working on trying out lots of different exercises. We have EMG on the lower extremity so we can make sure those muscles are not working very much. We have EMG on the core muscles so we can see median frequency changes. and we're, again, trying to assess these exercises by how they affect the person's response to perturbation when we go back to the control task, as well as their perception of whether they could do any more or they're completely exhausted. Then step three is to test on novice runners to see how their running mechanics change as we put them through this lumbopelvic control knockdown protocol. Now these novice runners, this is from a run in San Francisco earlier this year, they're all Elvises, so you know Elvis Presley has really good lumbopelvic control. So maybe these guys will not respond the same as our regular runners, but we're gonna see with the novice runners. And then step four would be to develop better injury prevention programs. The other thing we're trying to do is use simulations, and many of you may be familiar with OpenSim, but basically we can ask what-if sort of questions. What if the muscles were weaker? What if the activations or the activation dynamics were different? Or what if the kinematics was altered? We can actually explore that in the simulation, which we can't do in vivo. So here's just one example of what we've been trying to do. We took six subjects, which are exemplars of different running styles. Then we did the baseline, and then we reduced the activations of their muscles, their core muscles, the obliques, the erectors, psoas, and iliacus, to have the same general pattern but a lower magnitude, to 80% or 60% of original, to simulate fatigue or something like fatigue. And we wanted to know how the loads in the lower extremity change, how do other muscles compensate, perhaps. So this is just one of the results. It's tibial internal rotation angular impulse, which is sort of the cumulative load in one gait cycle acting to twist that tibia inward, which may result in maybe maltracking of the patella, maybe increased tension on the IT band. So this might be a loading parameter that might be important for those injuries, IT band syndrome, patellofemoral pain. So here's the baseline angular impulse for a subject who runs with high lumbar flexion, so a lot of range of motion like this. And then low lumbar flexion is a very stiff trunk in the sagittal plane. High lumbar rotation, which is transverse rotation, and then low. And then a long stride length and a short stride length. So you can tell that this person who runs with a lot of high lumbar rotation has a lot of this transverse angular impulse as well. But as we reduce the activation of those core muscles, we can see we go from the yellow is 100%, red is 80%, the black is 60%. As we reduce the core muscle contribution, what we see in five out of those six subjects is an increase in this angular impulse experienced at the knee. So this is just an initial result, and there's no statistics because these are individual subjects, but it gives us some ideas for what we should do moving forward. And in the future, we're trying to maybe think about, can we optimize running technique to minimize risk of injuries, whether we could reduce the load in the joint or maybe improve fatigue resistance by quote-unquote spreading the work among more muscles. We're trying to increase the sophistication of the model, so you're adding much more fibers and more muscles to that core. And then also looking at whether there's a best technique for everyone. So it could be that for short runners with short stride lengths, maybe it's a different approach that will maximize their efficiency or performance relative to somebody who's tall and heavy. But then another question is the metabolic cost of stability, whether it's you have to trade off between being more stable and being more efficient, or whether those two can come together. These are all things that we may be able to explore in simulation, so we're really looking forward to that. So in summary, there's some growing evidence that it does matter, that there is importance of lumbopelvic control for prevention of lower and upper extremity injury. And I think future simulation and in vivo studies are going to improve our understanding of how much influence lumbopelvic control has, and maybe even how best to train it. So next will be Dr. Cholowicki talking about how best to measure it. Hopefully he'll talk about how I could improve. But just I want to stop with the acknowledgments of our funding sources and my co-authors on these studies. Thanks.